together to meet with Christ, to lift our hearts in praise and worship to him. In order to do that, let us first call to mind and confess our sins.
Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us praise God's glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, we beseech you mercifully to hear the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may both perceive and know what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to fulfill them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please sit for the first reading. First reading is taken from the book of Exodus. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water. And the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response in the psalm, "Remember, O Lord, Any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself, being obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both
to work for his good pleasure. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
when Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later, he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same. And he answered, 'I go, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. But John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him, and even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Opportunity to reflect on them.
By what authority do you do and say the things that you do? Say religious powers of the day to Jesus. The New Testament uses two words for power. One is exousia, power to be able to do something, which we mostly translate as authority. That's the case here. And the other is dunamis, from which we get false dynamo, power as in force, the kind of power that a hurricane might exert. Of course, world leaders get to use both. They are people with power of authority who can use that to exert the power of force when they judge it to be necessary. In our reading, the chief priests ask Jesus what the source of his authoritative power is. Now, we as Christians, we naturally take against the chief priests, as they are the buddies in the gospel. But as is often the case, then as now, things are not quite as black and white as they may seem. To set this passage in its proper context, the previous day, Jesus has entered into Jerusalem on a donkey to triumphant acclaim by the people, and then gone straight to the temple and acted like a crazy man, violently driving out the merchants and the money changers in his own first century version of a not exactly peaceful political protest. Who does he think he is? What legitimacy does he have to do these things? He's just some small town preacher from Galilee who shows up in the great capital Jerusalem and starts acting like he owns the place. No wonder the religious authorities are put out. We, of course, see them as the bad guys. But actually, their challenge of Jesus is quite reasonable. They are responsible for the space that he has just disrupted. They do have the authority to ask, by what authority is he acting? The reason we see their question for what it actually is, an attempt to shore up their own power base in the face of a threat, is because we know who Jesus is. And we also know that his power is of quite a different order to theirs, with theirs being merely of human origin. Jesus is the Son of the Father, God incarnate. That is the source of his power. And so the religious leaders asking him where he gets his authority from and commanding him to stop, it's a bit like King Canute sitting on his throne on the beach commanding a tiger not to come in. It's a kind of apples and pears of powers, power and authority. It's just a bit ridiculous, really. But instead of pointing this out, Jesus tells the chief priests a parable to try and help them understand how his kind of power works. And he doesn't do it by talking about how important and mighty he is, and how, in actual fact, the whole world was created through me. A claim which would make it sound a little bit like Donald Trump, I fear. He does it instead by telling a story about relationships. A man says to his first son, "Please go and work in the vineyard today." The son refuses point blank, in fact, rather rudely. But later, he goes. The man also asks his second son to put in a few hours at the vineyard that day, and he replies very respectfully, "I will go, sir," but he never does. There's a mine of information about power, authority and force, respect and relationship in just those few sentences. The man obviously has authority over his sons in a fundamental sense. After all, he is their father. And his request that his sons will work presumably for the benefit of the family and the community is quite reasonable. But he doesn't force them. He doesn't actually march them down to the vineyard himself and make sure that they get stuck in, threatening penalties if they don't obey him. He simply asks, and then waits to see what will happen. Their responses will show whether they recognise and respect his authority. And appearances are deceptive. One looks as if he doesn't, but really he does. The other is the opposite. And surely the point is that such a thing as genuine respect for authority cannot be forced out of a person. It is a matter of esteem and honour, of affection and loyalty, or to use religious language, love and faithfulness. And no amount of force or power will succeed in demanding and extracting such a response. It can only be freely given by the individual. I sometimes like to turn to my favourite Aesop's fable to demonstrate this point. Remember that one about the wind and the sun having an argument about who's the most powerful? Seeing a man walking along the road below them, the sun suggests the matter can be settled by seeing who can get the man's coat off his back. The wind blew hard and howled, but the man was chilly and held his coat even more tightly about him. Then the sun shone, becoming gently warmer and warmer, and the man quite naturally took off his coat. And so too with God. Our powerful and mighty God has complete authority and does not deal with us by force. He doesn't wield power by demands and threats of hellfire or even 10,000 pound fines. Because if you look closely at the power of God, you will see the face of Jesus Christ, whom Paul tells us was in the form of God, and yet didn't regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. Power and authority which lays down its claims for the sake of service through self-emptying, self-giving, not self-promoting and exploiting, and so can be trusted, respected, loved even. God does not compel us, but instead he calls, he asks, sometimes he challenges. But it's always by way of invitation. Will you go and work in my vineyard today? Not because I'm going to compel you, but because you respect my authority and you trust that I have your best interests at heart. And because this work is important for all of us. I will leave you to ponder how these principles might translate into the kind of behaviour which might encourage a greater sense of trust in those who have been placed in authority over us, and so to recover the sense that we really are all in this together. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we rejoice to be here in your presence at our beautiful church on this somewhat grey autumnal morning. We give thanks and praise to you for your creation and love for us and our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we pray that we may hear and understand your teaching and observe your authority, and that we understand the teachings of your prophets too, so that our lives may be enriched and our understanding deepened. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Jesus, we pray for all those who are suffering because of COVID-19 and other misfortunes and disasters. And we pray especially for all those who are suffering that they may be comforted and supported, and that their health and lives may be repaired and restored. And we pray that all the world's leaders may together reach a better and fuller understanding of the challenges and how we may overcome them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for all those who work in public services and for the public good. We remember those in the health service who have died in the course of providing our health services. And we remember especially the police service. And we pray silently for a few moments for Sergeant Matt Turner and his family and friends who so sadly grieved him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, our God, we give thanks to all those who lead and help at St. Matthew's. We pray especially for Mother Helen, for Father Alistair, for Jonathan, musicians, welcomers, flower arrangers, readers, and for the tea and coffee service when they're allowed to. And we pray for Archbishop Justin and our bishops Christopher and Richard, and for the people of our twin diocese of Matabeleland, and our bishop Clear Fungus Lunga. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for all those who are unwell. And this week, our prayers are asked especially for Linda Darlington, Jess, Kurt Betton, Keith Renton, and Simon Ovens. And we pray for those who have recently departed. And our prayers are asked especially for Rachel Condon, Anne Rivaldi, and Eileen Cromwell. And we also pray for those whose anniversary of death occurs at about this time. And our prayers are asked especially this week for Gwyneth Llewellyn. And we pause again and reflect for a few private moments on our own special intentions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We praise St. Mary, St. Matthew, and all the saints and angels whose example may guide us. But we pray especially to St. Mary by praying together, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And finally, we pray together, Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand for peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconcile us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen High Priest. Make yourself known in the breaking of bread. Amen. The Lord be with you. sunrise to sunset, this day is holy, for Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day, as the Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live an endless life, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so with choirs and angels, and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night when he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to you, saying, "Drink you all of this. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ has risen.
Christ will come again. So, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Mary, Matthew, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. As Jesus taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the Lord is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we are sharing in one place. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb of God. Blessed are those who are called in supper. Lord,
thank you.
through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please sit for the notices. Well, it feels a bit like Low Sunday today, doesn't it? We had a goodly number last week, and I'm hoping that we will have a goodly number next week for our Jerusalem Challenge. It's Harvest Festival, so do bring your gifts for the Wimbledon Food Bank, specified herein. And if you like a bit of a jig about and a bit of a dance, which I know you all do, don't you? Some people shaking their heads, other people nodding really enthusiastically, or maybe it's just me. Next week is our all-age mass, as you know, and we are pumping that out to fever pitch excitement for our young people. Apolline over there will be enjoying, yes, that's you, having a bit of a dance about next weekend as we dance to Master KD's dance track as a way of rejoicing and giving thanks for our harvest gifts. If you don't know what I'm talking about, then have a look at my email, and indeed I might send out another one just to really bombard you. If you want to come, please could you let us know, that's myself or Rachel, the administrator, because for the all-age masses, because we do have a lot of people here, we do try to get the seating right so that we can social distance everybody properly. So please email me or Rachel if you would like to come. Now, Soulscape, is there anyone left here who has not tried out Soulscape? Some people are putting their hands up. Okay, now's your opportunity, because guess what? It's on Thursday. It's on Thursday, and it's live here in this church, and it's great. And the person who will be giving the reflection this month is our very own Janice. There she is. Oh, no, that's good. I'm just working. Okay, I'm not going to move that down. It's Janice. Here she is. And she will... She'll be giving our reflection on, I think, the subject of Michaelmas and the angels, because it's Michaelmas this week. So do please come along and get peace and comfort guaranteed, absolutely, if you come to Soulscape. I think that's all the notices, so now please stand for the blessing. God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain.